90.9, right?
Yeah. Good morning on this beautiful Wednesday morning on the island of Guam. You're listening to Catholic Educational Radio, KOLG, 90.9 FM in Agana. It's time now for the Friends and Family Show. To the Friends and Family Show here on KOLG 90.9 FM, another edition on this beautiful island of Guam, blessed by our Savior, our Lord. I'm Tony Diaz, the host of this program that comes to you live every Wednesday at 9 a.m. And then we rebroadcast on the following Thursday at 2 p.m. And then we're blessed to rebroadcast the recording on Fridays at 7 p.m. On the Friends and Family Show, we are called that because we invite friends and family members of our Catholic faith, really our Catholic family on Guam. And I'm really glad to be joined in studio from the Immaculate Heart of Mary, the pastor and several of his parishioners. First, welcome Father Val. Thank you so much.
Well, thank you very much, Tony, for inviting us this morning to be able to share, you know, our parish.
I'm just so privileged to have you, Father Val Rodriguez, the pastor. And then he has come here with several longtime parishioners. Welcome first to Mrs. Eden America. Good morning and thank you.
Good morning, Tony.
And a man that I consider a mentor and a role model for me, an old Catholic man, a longtime friend, Mr. John Taito. Good morning, John.
Good morning, Tony. Good morning, Guam.
Yes, good morning, Guam. Thank you to all of you. And besides coming to you live on Catholic Radio, KOLG 90.9 FM on the radio for now, we're blessed to be having the, by virtue of Father Val, the Immaculate Heart of Mary is live streaming this. Father Val, will you share with them the link that people on the radio can access to watch this and hear this live?
Yeah, actually, we are putting it online also on our Facebook account of the Immaculate Heart of Mary Toto. That's okay. How the account name is.
Great. Make sure to speak directly to the mic and capture your sounds really well. So we're having a great time. As we always do in all shows and programs of the KOLG, we begin with a prayer. And if you flip to the back of your guides, Father and Eden and John, we've been praying a prayer to Saint Joseph. So Father, would you lead us in this prayer that I spotted on the USCCB website, I believe, that Pope Francis prayed to St. Joseph.
Okay, of course. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen. Amen.
Hail, Guardian of the Redeemer, Spouse of the Blessed Virgin Mary, to you God entrusted His only Son. In you Mary placed her trust. With you Christ became man. Blessed Joseph, to us too, show yourself a Father, and guide us in the path of life. Obtain for us grace, mercy, and courage, and defend us from every evil. Amen. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen.
We were able to fix the mic levels, Father, of your mic, and apologies to people who are listening. So here we are on the Friends and Family Show, welcoming Immaculate Heart of Mary. We will discuss and talk about the upcoming festal celebration of the Immaculate Heart of Mary in Toto Parish, and also the history of Toto Parish. But as to begin with, so that we give a little bit of insight and background on each of our guests, Father, will you tell us a little bit about yourself and what was your assignment? First of all, how long have you been at Immaculate Heart of Mary, and what were your assignments before then?
Okay, so first of all, again, thank you, Tony, for giving us this opportunity to be able to share about ourselves and also about our parish mission. Well, I'm Father Val Rodriguez. I do not really belong to the Archdiocese of Bagania. I'm temporarily here. My bishop allowed me to stay here, and I'm so happy that Archbishop Michael Jude Burns accepted me to be doing my ministry here at the moment. So at present, I am the parochial administrator of the Immaculate Heart of Mary Parish. I don't really have the title of pastor, but the very simple reason that I don't technically belong to the Archdiocese of Bagania.
I promoted you.
Yeah, but technically it's the same. It's a matter of terminology.
You have all the responsibilities,
yes,
and
the
challenges
same.
And headaches sometimes.
Yeah,
right?
It's more of the technicality of you cannot have the term pastor because you're not really incarnated into the Archdiocese.
Yeah.
But practically the roles and functions is the same. So before Immaculate Heart of Mary, I've been in Immaculate Heart of Mary for 2 years now. I was appointed there as parochial administrator May 1, 2019. So I'm just 2 years and 1 month something in the parish. Before that, I was at the cathedral here at Dulce Nombre de Maria,
yes,
Cathedral Basilica for 9 months, I believe. So I came here August, and then May, I was transferred to Immaculate Heart of Mary. I belong to our diocese. It's not really called a diocese yet. It's a vicariate, in the apostolic vicariate of Taytay in Palawan, Philippines.
Wow.
So if you remember, Tony, I don't know if you remember, I was at St. Anthony before, during,
yes,
that was 2015 to 2019. I was there for 4 years, and at the same time, I was teaching at the St. Thomas then,
yeah,
the St. Thomas Catholic High School.
You're definitely not a stranger to the church on Guam.
Yeah.
Even though you're not incarnated, you've been here and you've helped us tremendously. I remember also the late Fela Morena. I think you were.
Yes.
Did you do the eulogy on the homily?
I think so. My memory is really very good. So I was here at the cathedral for 9 months. Before that, I went home. After St. Anthony time, I was at 2015 to 2019, I was St. Anthony. I went home to Palawan for 4 years, and then I came back here. So,
yeah.
And the truth is, my first parish experience was at St. Anthony. Before,
nice.
When I was ordained in 1998, my assignments are all seminary. I was teaching in the seminary for quite a period immediately after I was ordained a deacon. So yeah, and now I'm happy serving the Immaculate Heart of Mary Parish here in Toto.
And from what I understand, they're happy to have you as their parochial administrator.
I hope so. I pray to God that I
Wonderful, Father. Thank you so much for that. And Miss Eden, you have been at the Toto Parish for a long time.
Yeah, I've been there since 1982. I think I have served six priest already, Father Miguel, so-and-so, and then the last one is Father Val. I am the president of the Christian Mother of Toto.
Oh, nice.
We have a lot of project also I am also as father, I am also as a decorator. Sometimes I am a lector.
All around.
I'm an all around girl. So ask for it.
Thank you so much, John. The parish is just one place that you're so busy and active with your wife, Maria. But tell us more about you and your background and your history with the parish.
I started out at the Immaculate Heart of Mary in way back in 1959 after my dad retired from the U.S. Navy. At the time, it was Father Juan Camacho, I believe. And then Father Ben Martinez came in, Monsignor Ben now. Well, rest in peace. Yes. And at that time, a lot of the parish was just starting to develop. We were a mission parish under the cathedral here in Agana. Mm-hmm. And so our priests would come from the cathedral, and it was kind of nice because back in those days, we didn't have streetlights. So we always knew if we were going to be late because we could see Father coming on the road. But that's another story to be told. I've been with the parish. I serve Father Val here with the parish council. I also serve at the San Vicente Catholic School, the finance council. I serve with the archbishop to the ministry of the homeless.
Yes.
And among other things, you know, when I'm called to perform, we do it, you know. And I'm very grateful having our spiritual leader, Father Val Rodriguez. He's brought a tremendous flavor of spirituality to our parish. And for that, I'm sure all our parishioners are grateful, because despite the pandemic that we've gone through, I can attest that we haven't really skipped a heartbeat.
Nice.
We've done things different, but we've done things in accordance to protocol, and most especially in accordance with public health has mandated. So he wears a large hat, and for that we are tremendously grateful. I can go on for days with this, but I'm going to leave it at that for now.
Just consider it maybe the first installment of having John and Father and Stephen. We've been blessed to have members of our church here. Last week I had Tricia Tenorio, our Safe Environment Coordinator, to discuss the many things the church is doing. We can't do enough, but the many things we're doing and we must do to help protect our very young children, our innocent children, safety from abuse and all harm in general. Before that, we had Ms. Lisa Baza Cruz, who, out of her generosity and her school community at St. Francis, had been doubling as acting principal of San Vicente as well. And before that, we had, I was sharing with you off the air, the class of 1975 of San Vicente, who had recently donated, just among themselves, put the money together and donated a sum of $1,300. To San Vicente School, and a nice plaque in honor of the late Sister Lydia Marie. We also had Dr. Juan Flores here to talk about Catholic schools in general. And we are going to, next week, welcome Father Joseph Anori and his parishioners. I believe Bill Polino will be one of them. And I spoke to Father Carl, who also this weekend will be celebrating not the major festal celebration of Our Lady of Peace and Safe Journey, but the festal celebration of our Sacred Heart of Jesus.
Yeah.
So man, the church is busy as ever. As you said, John, we don't, you haven't, and the parishioners and the faithful in general haven't missed a heartbeat. And I imagine, and I suspect that the Sacred Heart of Mary, Immaculate Heart of Mary, has helped you as well, of course, as our God, our Father, and His loving heart. So we are the Friends and Family Show. We're here with Father Val Rodriguez, parochial administrator of Immaculate Heart of Mary in Toto, Mrs. Eden America, president of the Christian Mothers, Mr. John Titano, with the finance council, or parish council as
parish
well,
council,
and many, many other things. All here on the Friends and Family Show. We'll be back, and we're so glad that you joined us. A reminder that Immaculate Heart of Mary is also live streaming. What is that link again, Father?
Immaculate Heart of Mary Toto.
Okay, that should be easy to...
Immaculate Heart of Mary Toto.
So we'll be right back. We're going to... I have this nice CD because I was like, oh boy, I get to play a lot of Marian music. This is called Catholic Hymns, Catholic Classics, and this song is simply called Immaculate Mother Ave Maria. So we'll be back here on KOLG 90.9 FM in Agana. Immaculate Heart of Mary. This is the Friends and Family Show. We were checking the live stream of Immaculate Heart of Mary Toto Parish, and it's coming through. So welcome to those who are following. And if you're following on Catholic Radio or the live stream, please tell your friends, your family, your neighbors, cousins, your cousin, neighbor's cousins, brother, you know, how that goes in Guam. And we welcome the listeners and supporters of Catholic Radio. I'm here, Tony Diaz, the host of the weekly program that comes to you live every Wednesday at 9 a.m. And then we also come to you on a rebroadcast basis the following Thursday at 2 p.m. And then finally 7 o'clock on Fridays. So we're glad to welcome once again in studio having a great conversation with Father Val, the Poliarco Administrator of Immaculate Heart of Mary. For short, we know the acronym IHOME, right?
Yes.
It's easy to spot and easy to remember. and of course Toto, and we also have Mrs. Eve in America and Mr. John Titanol. Wow, great. So we were learning a little bit more about our three guests, and now let's talk about the parish and the fact that you're going to be celebrating your Feast of Immaculate Heart of Mary. Go ahead, Father, you want to tell people about it?
Yeah, so we shall be celebrating the Feast of our Patroness, the Immaculate Heart of Mary. It will already be this Saturday. Okay, it's really perfect timing that we are celebrating the feast on the real date of her feast day.
Yeah.
Because it really happens on that day. So we shall be celebrating the feast of our patroness, the Immaculate Heart of Mary, this Saturday, that is June 12. And our celebration that day will be at 5 o'clock in the afternoon with, of course, our celebration of the Mass to be presided by, of course, no less than our own father of the Archdiocese, our own Archbishop Michael Jude Burns, at 5 o'clock in the afternoon. Our novena has been ongoing, of course. We decided to have our novena first, the 9 days. We started June 3, that is a Thursday. Today, I believe we are already at the end on the seventh day, right?
Yeah.
On the seventh day of our novena. So the last day of our novena will be on Friday. So we're done with the novena. And the 10th day, which is June 12, the Saturday, is really the fiesta celebration. That's how we did it this year. And so, with the celebration of the Mass with the Archbishop on Saturday, the motorcade procession will be the following day, that is Sunday, at 5 o'clock in the afternoon.
That's a great and innovative way and a safe way as far as the pandemic or the COVID-19 virus to still... honor Mother Mary, celebrate her feast day of Immaculate Heart of Mary, but yet keep distance between the faithful.
Yeah, that's true. I think that's one of the, I was telling my parishioners in the past 2 weekend masses already that in a way the motorcade procession, I mean reflecting about it, I said it's beautiful. Beautiful in a sense that, you know, the practice, once we have the usual procession of the, you know, when we walk for the procession, we have a very short route. Of course, I think the reason is very obvious for everyone. We just go and how many meters away, John, right, from the church, and then we make a U-turn back. I said, you know, I think this pandemic, in a way, has a lot of beautiful things have brought given us, like this motorcade procession. The beauty of it is, we're able to process her in the whole parish jurisdiction.
And those who are homebound, for instance,
and
cannot be as mobile and go down to the actual church, they can hopefully make it out to their doorway and just welcome our Mother Mary.
Yeah, for me, it's a symbolic showing of Our Lady. This is our parish. We ask you for your intercession, seeing the condition of our people in every street and corner of our parish. Very beautiful, I said.
Yeah, I know other parishes have been doing that. And of course, reminiscent of the big, big, twice now, the motor, well, it's not a motorcade, but the Immaculate Heart of Santa Maria Camelot, going island-wide. It was December, of course, December 8th, and then last May, as the island joined the rest of the United States and Canada, to a reconsecration of Mother Mary.
Yeah, that was the start of it, I think, in the whole Archdiocese, right? I just don't know outside of Guam, but in the Archdiocese, that really started the concept of it, right? With the Santa Maria Camelot going around the whole island.
Yes.
Beautiful.
Yeah. And if you, persons who are listening or following through live stream, if you want to look at the schedule of the novena, the nightly novenas, you can go several ways on the Facebook pages of Umatuna Sedulus. You just look for Umatuna Sedulus on the Facebook, or Archdiocese of Agana on Facebook. We also have it on our website, archagana.org. And I imagine that you have it, you probably have it on your website, Father.
It's on our website, and it's also live streamed both on our Facebook account and YouTube account.
Yeah.
So we always simulcast on those two.
Do you have
platforms.
A intention for each night? Or do you remember, like, tonight?
Oh, no. Last night, the intention was on right balance, you know, to have a balance in our life.
Oh, that's beautiful.
Which is, I think, one of the most difficult, thing to do in life, to have a balance of everything. Anything in excess is bad. As we always say, virtus is not in medio, right? And
yeah.
virtue stands in the middle, how to balance things. So the yesterday, that was the intention, to have a balance of everything in our life.
That's great. That's really great. This is the Friends and Family Show. Let's talk about the history of the Immaculate Heart of Mary. Or do you anything else about the...
The procession, Tony, around the village. The reception last year, of course, the pandemic started last year.
Yes.
And so we kind of modeled our our procession around the village on that. And the reception was just tremendous. I mean, we were not expecting people to be on the side of the road throwing flowers at the Blessed Mother.
Yeah.
And everything. So we are able to maximize bringing the Immaculate Heart of Mary to the village.
Yes.
And I think the people were very, very receptive to that. And again, you know, Father Val was the one who created the float and everything. And we just got a bunch of gentlemen from the village that donate their time and efforts,
yeah.
their vehicle. And what we try to do is keep the procession to a minimum of vehicles because of the routes that we take.
Yeah.
The traffic. If we were to take everybody with us, if we were going to go into Taluba Street and the people of Toto know where Taluba Street is, it would take us all day to U-turn everybody around. So we ask, you know, everybody's cooperation and stand by your house, you know, wave at the Blessed Mother, throw the flowers like you did last year.
Yeah.
That is a great testament to Our Lady,
yeah.
you know, and that is how we would like to convey and bring the Blessed Mother to your homes,
yes.
and you receive her blessings on her day.
And of course, many Catholics have their different little statues of our
yes.
Blessed Mother. Sometimes they're so little, right? But they have.
And they wave them, you know?
Yeah.
It's so heartwarming. Yeah.
Father, let's remind again, maybe there might be a Protestant brother or sisters or others who are listening and say, oh, you know, worship statues. But could a very brief catechesis explaining why we don't worship statues? I've never, in all my life, as important as statues are, and we honor the saints and we honor definitely Mother Mary, but we don't worship statues.
So, yes. Of course, first thing is that as Catholic, we believe in only one God, and that is the Trinitarian God, which we celebrated just the feast, right? The Blessed Trinity. That's our only God. He's our only God. We only worship Him. Okay?
Yes.
And all of these saints, including the Blessed Virgin Mary, we call them, of course, as saints. Being saints, we believe that they are already, of course, with God the Father.
Yeah.
And so the first role that they have in our life is really to intercede for us. That's why I always tell my parishioners, you know, when you pray to the saints, don't ever forget, they're only intercessors. Because sometimes when we pray to them, it's as if they will be the ones to give us,
yeah.
like Immaculate Heart of Mary, like if you're a farmer, give me the rain.
Yeah.
No, I mean, I would say as a priest that the proper way to do that is say, Immaculate Heart of Mary, please pray to the Father to give us rain.
Yeah.
It's really God who gives us the rain. So we worship God, we venerate and reverence, of course, the saints because we believe that they are already with God. And secondly, they become examples for us, models of our faith. And as you said, how about these images and everything? They are reminders of the real one. You know, there's a big difference between an idol and the image that we have now. When you say an idol, that means you worship that thing.
Yes.
But these images, we don't worship them. They are only reminders of the real one. That's why it's also wrong in a way when you get stuck with the image. It should only help you as a Catholic to connect to the real one. There's a real Jesus represented by this image of Jesus on the cross. There's a real Blessed Virgin Mary, which is represented by this image. But even though they are not the real ones, because they represent the real one, then we give honor, or rather we take care of those images. Because you won't break anything that represents somebody that you love, right? I mean, a good example always is picture of your mother,
yes.
picture of your father. Even though that's not your mother, that's your father, you won't tear that. It's sort of a disrespect of the real mother and father. So the same way in our relations with them, we venerate them, we don't worship them, but we take care also of their images as signs and symbols. That's why if you notice, a while ago when you were asking me about the procession, I said it's a symbol of the Blessed Virgin Mary being shown the parish, because it's her image. That's not really her, but it's a symbolic way of Loving Mother. This is our parish. We ask for your intercession because you're our patroness.
Wonderful. That's why I look forward to having you on the as a guest, Father, because I knew you'll be able to really uphold the part of the name of our KOLG is the Catholic Education Radio. It's a little bit long, but we exist to share the faith and to teach and learn also about our faith. So thank you. God bless. Anything else about the festival celebration? I imagine that just as all our parishes too, because such big hearts at our parishes, where every time there's a festival celebration, whether it's the pandemic or regular times, whether there was Toto tomorrow or processions, or now where we have to tone it down, just have the festival mass and then the procession with the cars, the motorcade. Yeah. You're always, our parishes are always welcoming other faithful of the island to come celebrate.
Yeah, so I would like to, Mrs. America, to share about our pantry. Yes. Because, Tony, so with this situation that we are right now, of course, the usual island tradition, right? You have mentioned the Natautaw Tumano. I hope I pronounce it correctly.
Yes,
you know, it's a dinner after fiesta, which is done, I think, in wherever you are, even in the Philippines, we do the same thing.
Nice.
But because of this pandemic, we decided that instead of the Natautaw Tumano, we find it more meaningful if instead we invite our parishioners to donate to our pantry for the less fortunate. We really would like to be of help to our brothers and sisters, even though our help may be just a little, but we want to show the love of God and care for them in spite of the pandemic. So Mrs. America is the one in charge of our pantry. Perhaps she can share.
Okay. Our Immaculate Heart of Mary pantry is open on every Wednesday from 9 to 11 a.m. We cater to all the people of Guam and all of the villages. I have met them already. Because they go to the pantry with all their ID and mayor's verification. I wonder, where did you come from? Agat, Manolo. So, as of now, our staff are being depleted. So we're asking help from the public to donate in one way or another. So that one will be given to those unfortunate people.
What number can they call?
477-9118. That's the church phone.
Wonderful. So if you can help, as they help other people, our hungry brothers and sisters, please, give of your heart. And God, that's so great. And I noticed whether it's the ministry to the for the homeless, whether Catholic social service, or the individual parishes with their food drives and pantries. We don't say, oh, what, are you Catholic? Are you not Catholic? No, sorry.
Yeah.
No, we help.
Yeah,
you know, the church gets a lot of criticism sometimes from people who don't really know and understand us, but only focus on maybe the bad news that they see or hear or that they create themselves. But when they stop to think about it, there's so many good things that we do, not only inside our parishes and schools, but universally. Even beyond our island, right? So when there's a disaster in the Philippines or other parts of Asia or even in the mainland United States, we're quick to rally and have drives at our schools and parishes. So I'm a proud Catholic and I'm proud to defend us. Great. Oh, anything else about the festival celebration other than you want to extend again? And people can follow on the live stream.
Yeah. So again, the activities in connection to the festival celebration is our novena. It's already ongoing. We are on the seventh day today. By the way, our celebration is always every 5:30 in the afternoon.
Yeah.
I think people by now should already know that the Immaculate Heart of Mary, our schedule. People would normally ask me, Father, what's the time of the Mass? I know Tony posts all of those schedules of the parishes, but if you notice, we don't really say the time of the Mass. We just really begin always with the Rosary, Divine Mercy Chaplet, and Mass. So I tell them, Rosary begins at 5:30, and then it just goes. We can't really tell what time, but all our celebrations, Tony, are always like that. It's always Rosary, Divine Mercy Chaplet, and Mass. Well, I don't know if I should say this, but if people really opt to just, they really want to go to just Mass, how I wish they go to the Rosary and Divine Mercy, right? It's just once in a week, like a Sunday. Then they can just maybe 40 minutes, like if we begin at 5:30, Mass will be around 6:10, something like that.
Yeah.
So in this period of the Novena, instead of the Divine Mercy Chaplet, we have the Novena to the Immaculate Heart of Mary. So Rosary at 5:30, followed by the Novena, and then followed by Holy Mass every day.
And that's a great way, a beautiful way to prepare yourself for the source and summit of our faith.
That's true,
Mass,
yeah.
Because sometimes we're rushed, sometimes we're distracted, and we go to Mass, we go inside the church, but we're not fully prepared, right?
Yeah.
And sometimes we're socializing.
can I be very honest with you, Tony?
Yes, yes.
And everybody listening to us. It's for me as a priest, it's also a way of disposing my parishioners for the Mass.
Yeah.
Because if you don't have those prayers before, don't take this negatively, okay? If you're seated there and people around and somebody comes, you know, there's always a temptation to be conversing with one another. But it's a church. People should know that when you enter the church, it's not the marketplace, it's not the shopping place or what. When you go to church, you give reverence to the place because it's the house of God, as we always say. So in order to, you know, facilitate that atmosphere and disposition, I just say, let's have Rosary and Divine Mercy. That not because we're using it to dispose people, but it's real prayer. I think, as you mentioned, a good preparation, because if you just look at it theologically, you have the Rosary, which is, you know, devotion to the Blessed Virgin Mary, and then you have the Divine Mercy, which is Jesus Christ and God the Father already, and then the Mass. So there's like a kind of a hierarchy. You're like going up, you're building the theological, you know, framework.
That's wonderful. So remember, when you hear Father Val say that, remember, but also, you know, whisper it to your fellow Catholics or your family members if they're forgetting and they're getting carried away. Because it's an easy thing to do, because we're friendly and we're welcoming, but the most welcoming spirit of all, and our friendliness and our openness and our love, should be reserved for God our Father in the Holy Eucharist and just in the celebration of the Mass. So great, Father, great reminder. We're here on the Friends and Family Show, and you're here. We're so glad that you're tuning in to Catholic Radio. You know, we do have our issues. Our antenna is not the super-duper antenna that it should be, but by virtue of our faithful engineer, Bob Kelly, and his staff, like Jose Martinez, they keep us humming. And you know, we've existed since the early 90s. I think 92 or something like that. And my late dad, late deacon and judge Ramon Diaz, was also part of the helping to get the radio station going. So, and then you, the faithful, are listening and supporting us. So we thank you so much for that. We have Father Val Rodriguez, the parochial administrator, Mrs. Eden America, and Mr. John Titan, a longtime parishioner who have their roles, or their different roles, and the different ways they help. Let's tell people a little bit about the Immaculate Heart of Mary parish and the church, because like most of our churches, it's got quite a interesting history. And John, you're one of the most versed. I also pulled this from your website, Father. You want to? John has his pastoral center document. And I knew that he would be up from
there. Actually, when you asked me to bring two parishioners, I immediately thought of John. Because I'm sure, like, every time I'm invited to things like this, a very basic history.
Yeah.
And I'm new to the parish. I'm 2 years. So last night, I texted him, John, you study the history. Take care of that. Okay, John.
Sure enough.
Yeah, Tony. The Immaculate Heart of Mary Parish is a really diversified parish today. And that's a result, of course, of our spiritual leader. We welcome all ethnic groups. We're one of the few churches that actually have a dedicated Mass for the Islanders.
Yeah.
You know, and the participation at that Mass is just tremendous. You know, we open up to all ethnicities, and because we are all children of God. And we just need to make sure that we provide a house of worship for them, and it's not isolated to just the people of Toto, but the people of the island of Guam.
Yes.
So we're very happy to be part of that. We initially started as a mission parish way back in 1946 by the very Reverend Raymond Demers. He was a Capuchin bishop that arrived on Guam and established the missions of Nigua as well as Toto. Father Juan Camacho was one of the first local pastors of the village. Was one of the local spiritual leaders, because we were not yet a parish. And in 1962, Father Monsignor Ben Martinez was our pastor. And what we did, this was exactly, actually it was 1961-62, and Father Ben built a more permanent church at a different site, and on the holy ground, the chapel was 44 feet by 100 feet.
Wow.
And on May 13, 1962, this was exactly 45 years when the Blessed Virgin Mary appeared at Fatima in 1917 and asked the visionaries to have a devotion to her Immaculate Heart. The parishioners of Toto Mission happily witnessed the solemn dedication of the new and beautiful chapel by Bishop Apollinaris Baumgartner. Since then, some of our local priests have come through: Father Monsignor B.B. Arroyo, Father Monsignor David Defunto I. Quiroga, Father Manuel Cruz, Father Pedro Hurst. He was part of the Augustinian Recollects that came out to Guam. And Father Giuseppe, also a Recollect, and Father Miguel Echeviera. And then Father Simeon Balmeo. He was a really long pastor. He went from 89 to almost 94, and we rebuilt the Toto church with Father Simeon. And when Father Simeon left, I believe he retired, right?
Yes.
Yeah, Father Alfonso Assis came in, and then after Father Alfonso Assis came in, Father Manny Umbao came in, and after Father Manny Umbao, Father Mike Chrysostomo. After Father Mike Chrysostomo, it was Father Efren Adversario, and then we had Father June for a couple of months.
Yes.
And now we are blessed to have Father Val Rodriguez. I mean, if you knew Father Val Rodriguez's schedule when he was first appointed, you would say as a parishioner, oh, this is just another priest that doesn't have time for his parishioners. But let me be the one to attest to the fact that although Father Val came to the Toto Parish, he was able to do tremendous things. And the people, the parish of the Immaculate Heart, Father, we love you.
Oh, thank you. I'm just doing my mission. God's command.
Aside from being a priest, he's a well-known carpenter.
Carpenter.
Oh, man.
Very good one, too.
If you see our things, he made it.
Our altar, our
podium,
everything was built and designed by him.
What a blessing. Father, and then you also were live streaming, because you're no stranger to the technology. You used to do radio in the Philippines?
Yeah, well, back in my own diocese, I have my own radio programs also.
Man, you kept that a secret from us. So. But you know, if you want to do your own show at your schedule, maybe once a month.
Yeah.
he wants to have one.
I'll be taking away from the Toto Parish side. No, I'm just kidding, but gosh, this is wonderful sharing. See, that's what I say. There's so many stories that are untold, or stories that, because, you know, we're not, Father doesn't go around saying, hey, you know what, Archbishop, I'm also a good carpenter.
Yeah, right.
But hey, yeah, so I imagine St. Joseph is also one of your role models.
Everybody's telling me that, like, oh, you're St. Joseph. Yeah. Actually, I just tried doing that here in Toto because of the situation right now. Back in the Philippines, you know, life of the priest in the Philippines is different from our life here.
Yeah.
In the Philippines, honestly, you have everybody for every work.
Yeah.
That's just how it is there. You just really manage and everything. And of course, when I came here, the first time I came here, I have to do everything, like my laundry, clean the house, wash my car and everything. Back in the Philippines, you don't do that.
Yeah.
You do really your ministry and everybody takes care of all those things. And then when the pandemic started, imagine when we started March, remember, it's a lockdown.
Yeah.
That's right.
I believe I'm the very first priest to go live stream the mass.
I think so. I think
I was the very first one. So I on the very first day of lockdown, I immediately went live streaming. So I remember those days, I would go to the chapel early, prepare the mass, set up my laptop on a stand. And then, so I'll prepare the mass, I'll celebrate the mass, I'll go live streaming, I'll just click the button of my laptop, and there, I'm live. I do everything from preparation, readings, as in everything. Then after the mass, I go offline, I fix back everything, I put them back to order, and then go. So, yeah.
Have your brother priests, did they consult you? And
oh,
say,
no.
Can you give me any tips, or how do I do that?
No, I was just in one of our meetings, of course, without telling the others, no? And all of a sudden, the live streaming issue came.
Yeah.
And so I almost like said, I've been doing it, guys.
Yeah.
So that's how it started. And then it just developed when it was already Holy Week. So there's a big question mark for me of, I cannot do this alone anymore.
Yeah.
So that's when I started asking some friends I know who knows the gadget,
yeah.
You know, and then... That's it. That's how our live streaming came into a ministry now.
We just finished commemorating World Communications Day on the Sunday before Pentecost, I believe. And then that was followed by locally Catholic Communication Month. But the blessing of communication we've seen, and the blessings of this pandemic, even during these difficult times, that's one of the graces that our churches became skilled in. Almost all the churches have learned to live stream. And as you said, Father, it's just most churches don't have a specialized person who's paid just to do that. They're doing so many other things, and they learn that skill, or they have a little bit of background. But
Before, like, that area in the church, the whole church ministry, it's just like, it's not really there. But with this pandemic, I think the most, I would even say, allow me to say, the most busy ministry in the parish is the technology ministry.
Nice.
They have become into like the ministry.
How many people do you have?
Well, this is America, and I have four.
At San Vicente, I know that Father Joel does the show here at 3 o'clock every Wednesday,
mm-hmm.
later on today, and one of his Mr. Roland Bisco has started to do the camera there, and May Evaristo runs this control. And at St. Anthony, for instance, there's Father Mike has a great system there. And of course, let's talk about Cathedral Basilica.
Yeah.
They do a tremendous job, not only live streaming the Sunday Mass and on radio through Jose Martinez, but every day, whether it's in the chapel or the main church. But then, so the combination, Archbishop lifted the dispensation a couple of weeks now, and in Pentecost, Pentecost, and then but there still remains for those who are frail and elderly, and or who are anxious or homebound, because we need to recognize that
that's
as well.
True, yeah.
But are people coming back to the...
Yeah, that's why on that day, on the Pentecost, which is very meaningful. No? I mean, if you remember, the first reopening of the church also happened on Pentecost last year.
Yeah.
And then now it's the easing out of all of this and then lifting of the dispensation to go back again to the church. So beautiful it is that on the feast of the birth of the church, we really gather as a church. And then I told them that, you know, with this lifting, actually, for me personally, even without being without lifting the dispensation, we should really go to church.
Yeah.
Live streaming and TV mass, that's really for those who are sick.
Yeah, it's not considered fulfilling the obligation.
Yeah, it's not right. If you have no medical condition, you don't really honestly have that, you know, a sense of fear. Okay, if you have that tremendous fear of going out, then those are valid reasons. But if your reason is just saying, anyway, I'll just stay at home, there's live streaming. Oh, that's not right. The live streaming is meant for the sick brothers and sisters, and those have really valid reasons that they cannot physically be present in the church.
Yeah, and it was something that we would never have imagined, that there would be a general exemption or dispensation from. But we never imagined a pandemic like this and the challenges, right? So, but we want to make it clear again, everyone should, as usual, fulfill their obligation on Sundays and holy days of obligation. Just as in normal times, when those who are sickly and homebound and frail or prone to illness, you know, there's that dispensation or a word for it is really exemption, right, Father? Because someone asked me on my JFK 76 chat, you know, what does the Archbishop mean with this dispensation? We can kind of think of the tomorrow of dispensa, right? It's like
an exemption. Something like that, yeah.
But again, that's been lifted, okay, everyone? And come and meet Christ directly in the church.
Yeah.
And then this is what I also want to remind people. When we take in the body and blood of Christ, the actual Blessed Sacrament, the Holy Eucharist, it actually strengthens and nourishes us. It's not a fairy tale, it's not a myth, but it actually, God strengthens us among the many things that he does.
That's true, yeah.
Yeah, the blessing.
That's a spiritual nourishment. If we always nourish our body regularly in order for us to be healthy physically, then of course our spirit must be nourished also spiritually.
Yeah.
Through our prayers, devotions, and reception of the Blessed Sacrament.
So, John, the Immaculate Heart of Mary started out as a mission, not parish at first, but a mission chapel, right?
Chapel, correct.
1946.
Correct.
And then the next date, so you guys acknowledge that in your history, but there's several big important dates, but when was it again that it was established as the Immaculate Heart of Mary?
1962, with Monsignor Ben, Father Ben Martinez.
Yeah.
Yeah, and you know, one of the things at our parish what we do, because of the protocols that were made by the public health and the government, we were able to accommodate people at our social hall live streaming, as well as the chapel. We've opened up those locations for different things, and then when we have a big overflow, what we do is we space folding chairs out on the driveway up front. And we keep a speaker up front for those that don't want to get out of their car, you know, for them to be able to pick up the Mass as it is doing live. And then after Mass, the deacon or one of the Eucharistic ministers can give the body and blood, I mean the body of Christ, give the Eucharist. Mm-hmm. So, you know, Father Val thinks of everything, you know, and it's like, wow, man, he covered it. I mean, we've done many things in our parish as a result of this pandemic, but we've done them within the rules of the protocol.
Yeah.
And that, of course, is a direct result of great leadership. And so, once again, I can't stop, you know, praising this fine young man. He's so good to us.
You have a lot of good words.
And I realize how young you are, because you said you were ordained in 1998.
Yeah, really? I'm already 23 years a priest.
I thought you were going to say 23 years old.
No.
Yeah.
So when I was ordained, I was 25 years old.
Wow.
We just celebrated his ordination. May 23.
Yeah, most people would actually think like I'm young in the ministry. No, I'm already 23 years in the ministry.
Yeah, right. And then John, a short while ago you talked about that you're very inclusive in the parish. You have a strong Chukis Catholic community.
Yes.
Was Deacon, the late Deacon Anken Rumpan,
no,
was he?
No.
Deacon Itoy.
Itoy. Yeah, Deacon Itoy.
Itoy Roda.
Yeah.
And you know, even with that, we have also Deacon Anthony Leon Guerrero.
Yes.
We also have Deacon Rene De La Cruz.
That's right.
Yeah, so...
which is, I just realized now, John, right? As you said, we accept all... so we have the Chiquis, we have the Filipino, we have the Chamorro,
yeah.
Among the deacons.
Among the deacons, exactly.
Which is good.
Exactly. So, you know, we're blessed.
Let's talk about Mother Mary herself. I found this great reflection on the... let's see, it's copyrighted, My Catholic Life Incorporated. If you wanted to read more of this, it's mycatholic.life. But they give permission to parishes and archdioceses, as long as we're not making money in the actual sharing of it. And right now, I can see KOG is not making money for my show. I don't have underwriters. And so the big heart of this website, but if I may,
oh, here, let me share with you.
It's the second paragraph. I thought it was really beautiful, but you can. Okay. Okay. On today's Feast of Mary's Immaculate Heart, this is quoting now, the maternal warmth radiating from the core of Mary bakes the faithful soul. Our hearts glow when we look upon the seven pierced heart of the Mother of Jesus and commiserate with the holy longing in her tender eyes. Our love for Mary also softens our love for our Mother, the Church. Our minds know that the Church loves us and nourishes us with sanctifying grace, but intellectual convictions tend to be felt. In the same way that Christ concretely and historically images the Father, so too Mary images concretely and historically the Church. Mary is not a mere symbol of the Church, but anticipates and embodies what she gave birth to. Absent Mary, the Church would just be a little bit too hard, too distant, and too austere. It would be like a camping site or a large cold house, providing shelter but lacking a woman's touch. Mary converts the dry household of faith into a cozy family home. Without her heartfelt love, the house would simply not be the same, unquote. And again, it was God who gave us Mary, so he really gifted us with our Blessed Mother. Any thoughts or any things you want to impart about Mother Mary?
Yeah, I think what you just read, Tony, really captures the reason why the Blessed Virgin Mary, in her many titles, is really very close to the heart of, I think, all of us.
Yeah.
There's always there's a profound connection always with the child and the mother. We always long for a motherly care, and you know, of course, we have our God, but Mary being a mother, sometimes we feel more comfortable of approaching through her son Jesus Christ. So I think that really plays the maternal role, as captured in what you have read.
Beautiful, yes. And then talk about connections. You know, John, your wife is Maria, and then I have six older sisters. And they're all have Mary in their names. Because my mom and dad, they met first in the Legion of Mary in the Philippines. So there's a shout out to my sisters, Mary Lou, Mary Les, Mary Lynn, Mary Bell, Mary Ann, Mary Carr.
Oh,
then my late older brother Carl, and then three of us younger boys. Thank goodness that they didn't name me Mary at the end. But then when I married my wife, Mary, I wasn't planning it, but Mary, they called her.
Mary.
Oh, here's the seventh Mary now. Thank you so much.
Really
Thank
amazing.
You, Mother Mary. I mean, so many blessings.
Yeah.
Hey, we're almost done, and I do have to finish a little bit early so that I don't go over the time limit and go into Archbishop's recorded homily from Sunday. But any last words, Father, and our guests?
Yeah, I just would like to again invite all of our listeners, everybody, even though those who do not belong to our parish, it's a devotion to the Immaculate Heart of Mary. Again, our novena is ongoing, 5:30 Rosary, Divine Mercy Chaplet, the novena and then Mass. Okay, Rosary, novena, and then Mass. And then on Saturday, please join us. The Mass will be at 5 o'clock. It will be the festal celebration. And then on Sunday, the procession will begin at 5 o'clock in the afternoon. If I can just briefly mention the route. So out when we go out of the church, we will turn left to Aragon Street, and then turn right to Toto Cañada Road, and then turn right to Sergeant Roy Damian Street, and then if you're familiar with Taluba Street, we'll turn left there, and at the end of it, we will have a U-turn, go back to Roy Damian Street, and then turn left to Roy Damian, turn left to Clara Road, which actually leads to JQ San Miguel School, right by the gate of JQ San Miguel School. We'll make a U-turn back to Roy Damian, turn left to Roy Damian Street, turn right to Raymond Sanchez, and then we reach, of course, Route 8, turn right to Toto Cañada Street, turn right to Aragon Street, and then we're back to the parish. Okay. And please do not forget that the Immaculate Heart of Mary is closely connected to the feast before it, the Sacred Heart of Jesus.
Yes.
So don't ever forget that. So we celebrate the feast of the Sacred Heart of Jesus on Friday, June 11, and then we celebrate the feast, actually it's a memorial of the Immaculate Heart of Mary on Saturday, June.
And Father Carl and his group will be celebrating that this Friday.
Yeah, oh, the Sacred Heart.
We really have to go, but thank you so much, Father.
Thank you, Tony. Thank you.
Eden and John. Thank you, everyone.
Thank you, Tony.
Thank you, Tony.
Okay.
Thank you, Guam.
The teacher says, "Where is my
good
guest room
Tony.
Where
thanks.
I may eat the Passover with my disciples?"
Just give
then he will show you a large upper room furnished.
So to all of you who have watched us through live streaming, God bless you. And through the intercession of the Immaculate Heart of Mary, may God bless you. Thank you.
Oh, we don't have time for the closing prayer. But
he took bread, said the blessing, broke it, gave it to them, and said, "Take it, this is my body." Then he took a cup, gave thanks, and gave it to them,